Great. So yes, we're excited to be chatting today about Hazel Johnson's life and legacy, not only because it's Black History Month, we're looking towards Women's History Month, but also because Bobby Rush has introduced some federal legislation honoring Hazel and her legacy. And we wanted to share this tweet from his office. He says, Hazel fought tirelessly to correct injustices on behalf of her community, and we must not forget what she has done for environmental justice. And so one of the bills he mentions here would honor April as Hazel M. Johnson Environmental Justice Month. The other two would give her a posthumous Congressional Medal of Honor and put her on a postage stamp. So Tessina is going to talk a little bit more about this later in the program, but we just wanted to mention that. And we think it's really important, not just because we're excited that it honors a local figure, but because it raises a bigger platform for environmental justice generally. It's becoming more popular, but that often means that it loses some of its impact. And so this legislation would really help kind of lift up what environmental justice really is, which is people organizing in their communities for change and building power together, and really lifting up solutions to policy that addresses things like climate change and environmental contamination from those who are most affected. And certainly this week, we couldn't have a better example in our own city than the General Iron campaign and the work that happened on the Southeast side to stop General Iron's permit. So just want to shout that out, but super excited to be here to talk about environmental justice and to introduce our facilitator for the day, Mila Marshall, who's going to be leading a really great discussion. So Mila is the clean water advocate for the state chapter of the Sierra Club, and she works to mobilize and energize diverse networks across the state around clean water issues related to wastewater, agriculture, and industry. She advocates for novel partnerships that protect the quality of streams, lakes, rivers, and Illinois tributaries for all. Furthermore, she addresses the legacies of water infrastructure disinvestment by building bridges toward solutions through connecting and educating the scientific and legislative communities at the city, county, and state levels. So take it away, Mila.
Hello, everybody. I'm so happy to be here. Just as a reminder, we are recording in a little bit of Zoom grounding. So there will be time for questions, but please do populate the chat. Let us know your name, where you're calling in from, what organization you're affiliated with, if you're a member of People for Community Recovery, maybe if you're from Chicago, what side of town you represent. Shout out to the South Side. I'm really excited to be here today with my very special guest. Cheryl and I have worked in the same network for years, and I look up to her. I look up to her mom because there are so very few women of color that are active within the environmental community professionally. Everybody's doing a little bit in lots of different ways, so I don't want to discredit the environmentalism that happens in non-traditional ways, but in the spaces we operate in, nonprofits, foundations, and academia, there are few. And so if you do not know who she is, Cheryl Johnson is a longtime resident of Altgale Gardens, which is a public housing development on the far south side of Chicago. She is a mother of two, a grandmother of one. She's the daughter of the late Hazel Johnson, mother of environmental justice, who founded People for Community Recovery over 40 years ago. And now Cheryl has taken the reins to continue to fight for environmental justice and equality in Chicago. Cheryl has been with People for Community Recovery for the past 35 years as an administrative assistant to project manager and now the executive director of PCR. Ms. Johnson is a strong advocate, like her mom, on urban environmental pollution and its negative impacts on human health. She believes that climate change is real, like her mother stated two decades ago, that if America does not change its practices of damaging our ozone layers and emitting toxins into our air, water, we will see a change in our weather patterns. Today, her statement is true, and we call that climate change. And of all climates that we want to change, it's definitely the climate of awareness of inequity that people of color experience in Chicago and other places. And so, Cheryl, welcome.
Hey, thank you. Thank you, Maya.
You know what?
Glad to be here. I'm really glad to be here. And I'm looking at this picture, I just got to say, it's just like she's looking directly at me every time I look at it, you know. And so it's kind of touching right now because I'm looking and it's like she's looking at me back. Cheryl, that's what she's called me.
Right.
Hey, go ahead. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No. This is going to be really informal. And we've talked before that your mother loved music. And so you all are in for a treat because as Cheryl and I talk, we're going to go through her mom's life, but we're also going to be infusing it with a little bit of Marvin Gaye, which was her favorite singer. So you can advance, Caroline. When I think about your mother, I will admit it wasn't until maybe seventh grade that I even understood or knew what a landfill was. I had a science fair project called Which Environment Decomposes Waste the Best? And from there, I had to kind of teach myself about natural history. And so oddly enough, that is when I learned about my grandmother's migration story from Plaquemine Parish, Louisiana. Mm-hmm. I learned about my family growing up in Oak Hill Gardens, and mm-hmm. I learned about your mother. It wasn't something that was taught in school. And I'll be honest, as I was putting this together, Cheryl, I was kind of in tears because I realized like I am like one generation away from the woman who really is my inspiration. I see myself in her, and I'm so very proud to be able to talk to you about her life and share that. So thank you.
And I guess it makes it really special for you is that you walk the community that she loves so much and that she spent majority of her life living. You know, if she was alive today, I know she would still be living right out here, you know, so.
And you live at Oak Hill Gardens too, right?
Yeah, I still live here. Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk a little bit about, you know, your mother's early life and where she came from. You know, when you Google Hazel M. Johnson, it's all about Oak Hill Gardens, but she wasn't born and raised in Chicago. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, her early years?
Well, actually my mother was born in New Orleans. She was born at Cherokee Hospital. She lived in the Lower Ninth Ward. I keep forgetting the name of the street that she grew up in. And my mother lived there until she was like nearly 20 years old before she relocated to Chicago area. So she had a long time, you know, considering 20 years in New Orleans. You know, my mother had great stories that she used to tell me that, and I think out of her seven children, I'm her sixth, but I was just fascinated of her upbringing and, you know, a woman who life tremendously changed at the age of 12 and to be able to have seven kids and lose a husband to cancer and raise us, you know? And she would say she was an orphan at the age of 12, you know? So it's extraordinary to see, you know, the accomplishment that she had made. And it wasn't for any notoriety. It was based on the principle that she cared and it wasn't right. You know, and she always believed in for life, fight for what you believe in. So the challenges that she even have told me back when growing up in New Orleans, for an example, my grandmother, Mary, could pass for white. Now, you know how dark my mother is. And they used to have.
So this was Hazel's mom.
Hazel, my grandmother. And they used, my grandmother was a seamstress. So she used to, and my mother was the oldest child. She had a birth of three kids, but my mother was the only one that lived the longest. And she was make mothers and daughter dresses. So in New Orleans, they was like, why do you dress like this little, this in baby? And my mother used to say, her mother used to say, if you call my, you know, baby that one more time, I'm going to kick your butt, you know. But she didn't say butt, you know.
Right, because was, this was Jim Crow South, right?
Yeah, right.
You know, like,
so she was, you know, many a times that my mother tell those type of stories about how her mother defended her growing up and how she was spoiled, you know, but the connectedness that she had with her friends and her community, and my mother had the opportunity to catch the bus to school, but she would walk with the kids because they didn't have car fit, you know. So those stories, and then telling me other stories about conflict between neighbors and practicing voodoo, you know. Voodoo is a religion, but that's what they call it, you know. And she witnessed this for herself, you know, was even more fascinated. So it's a lot of history in New Orleans that is very interesting that I have learned from my mother. But I'm the one that always used to inquisit about her life when she's growing up.
As you share about your mom, you know, my grandmother came up in the 1930s, right, when your mom was born, at mm-hmm. Parrish. I think we're about a little bit north of New Orleans. And like you said, when I think about life in those years in Jim Crow South, how is it that someone can experience those traumas and still advocate for equity, still fall in love, still have families, still, you know, move forward with this zest for life and not let, you know, not let the reality of their situation get them down? And when I think about the connection between space and how it shapes us as a person, your mother was raised in Cancer Alley.
Right.
Right. Can you talk a little bit about what that space is in Louisiana?
Well, I think it was really close to the riverbank, as she said, that many times that with her father, that she would go fishing, you know, and they could literally just walk maybe two blocks away from their house and be right on the river. And it never dawned to them, the development of these industries in the area. I think my mother could say that she started seeing them by the time she got like 20 years old. It was a flume along the riverbank. So it's interesting, but she really didn't really talk about, because she didn't make that connection. Her, you know, it was more about family orientated, and she had a lot of segregated mothers who, because when her mother passed, some of her mother's best friend became, you know, play mom to her and all of those different things. So she really never made that connection to after she got grown. After she went to the first meeting, the first gathering of people who fight these type of problems all around the country, they convened it in New Orleans, the very first meeting with Dr. Buller, Ben Chavis, Beverly Wright, Darnell Wilkins, Connie Redden, Dana Alston. It was just so many of the pioneers who was fighting from every region of the country came to New Orleans. So that's when her level of understanding of making the connection that she was already born into it, and now she's fighting it in the very same neighborhood that she's raising her kids in.
And so before we go, So before we go to our kind of musical interlude, you know, when I think about New Orleans and how that's connected to me, and my family connected to the gardens and all of our like migration stories, like not everybody gets it, right? Mm-hmm. Like we live in these communities and we buy houses, we, you know, we move there on purpose, but not everybody is inspired to do something. And even though, you know, your mom was a part of it and seeing the petrochemical, you know, facilities and fishing in polluted water, mm-hmm. there was something that clicked for her when she heard. And so it's my hopes that, you know, everybody doesn't need to be Hazel, right? But what we hope is that people are willing to learn and listen and figure out how to support the Hazels of the world. So with that, Caroline, please advance. Sure, before we got on, you said Marvin Gaye was before his time, and I totally agree. Mm-hmm. It lends itself to the environmental movement so well. Caroline, please advance. And so I want to talk a little bit about the creation of People for Community Recovery and your mother's evolving advocacy and just the timeline. And so when you and I connected, you shared with me that People for Community Recovery and environmental advocacy wasn't the only thing that your mother was passionate about. So can you share a little bit about what she was doing or what she had done before she had gotten her feet dug in to environmental work?
My mother has always been an active person all my life that I have known to kind of understand the type of work that my mother have done through her lifetime. And she always was engaged in youth, making sure they had recreations in the community, for an example, making sure that we go places and explore places. And she even seen a huge disparity in transportation that she really didn't make this connection, but she got the level of understanding was the fact that we had to travel so far from Augier Gardens. And if we needed a free hospital, the only one that was accessible at that particular time was Cook County Hospital, you know? And she thought that was just too far for us to have to travel in order to get, you know, to get medical service. So she worked very hard to get the reopening of the Provident Hospital on 51st Street. And it took her a couple of years, but she attended every board commissioner meeting and testified every time and never changed her story. You know, so things happened in her last conversation with the commission, commissioner level that, which was the day that they approved to reopen Provident Hospital. A lot of people don't know that history right there. You know, my mother was also a founding member, and she was the chair of the recruiting department for the Woodline organization. Woodline organization was really around dealing with civil rights related issues, housing, inequalities and stuff like that, before she even moved to Auburn. So when she moved to Auburn, she became real very active. But Provident Hospital happened when she was living out here. Let me make that correction. But when she moved in Auburn Gardens, March 18, 1962, she was on the floor. I mean, she came out on the doorstep, being active in the community. But you know, back when in the 70s and late 60s and 70s, you know, cancer was really treated like a cancer. You know, it wasn't no discussion, wasn't no disclosure about people experiencing cancer in the area until you sit down on the porch and have conversation with folks. And then you start making those connections. And that's what my mother was able to do. She was a people person. People always came to talk to her, and people already have always come for her advice. So when these young ladies came to talk to her about their children, young as 2 years old, having developed cancer, and not just one cancer, multiple cancer in their bodies, you know, under the age of two, she became concerned. And then she made that connection because she heard that the South Side of Chicago have the highest incidence of cancer than any other area within the city of Chicago. And it was based on zip code. And not zip code at that particular time was 60627. I just come to learn within a few years now that that 60627 zip code was only designated for our area. We have a medical clinic right in Allgale, TCA Health, and they in the 60628 zip code, always has been. Interesting.
Right, knock on wood.
Carver High School is in...
Literally, it's inside Allgale Gardens. You got to get in there to kind of get back there.
It's not listed as at that particular time as a 6062. But they eradicated, they got rid of that zip code. We no longer, because we was the only one that had that zip code. And when that announcement came out, I mean, this is several years, this is decades later that I'm just coming to realize that we was the only one that had that zip code and they got rid of it. And I want to know, now inquiring minds want to know why. Why did you change? But they tried to tell us it was based on the closest postal service that is with us. But check this out. We in the zip code of a village, 60827. Everything in the city of Chicago is 606.
Right.
We are 608.
You know, for people that don't know about Allgale Gardens, it is its own city.
Island. Yeah.
Exactly. You know, like that's a good way to put it. And so I used to think there was one way in, one way out, but you actually can go, you can enter through a low income community that is Golden Gate. Golden Gate is right next to Allgale Gardens. And so you can get into it, but it's like this, you know, it's blocks that are kind of circle around. And I remember I used to be a lifeguard at Carver, and I remember getting lost in Allgale Gardens, and people know you're not from the gardens when you roll up in there. And I can remember like the stories of my mother. My grandmother was one of the first people to move into Allgale Gardens, and she said how beautiful it was, and there were rose bushes. But over time, you know, with all of the factories and pollution, things started to change, as well as the influence of and the presence of drugs. That community really started to dissolve. And so whether it's the grocery store that hardly had any goods or produce, the lack of transportation or how that transportation runs, or the services that people had access to. It is it's a challenging community to live in because it's so disconnected from the rest of the city.
You have to remember that Allgale was a viable community despite being so isolated.
Yep.
Since it's in itself, you didn't need to have to go outside the community for resources. It was heavily resourced within the community. As time passes and have politics played a detrimental role in the change that we are seeing, the changes of Allgale that I've got to experience. You know, I've seen where Allgale was a viable community, and the declining of it based on the political and the pollution in our community, because that determines who get polluted and who don't get polluted.
It's like, right.
We can't never remove ourselves, because I blame government for even building this place, because they knew this land was contaminated before they built it. And now you built it, you allowed us to live here for all these years, almost 80 some years. So you created a community.
On purpose.
You know, and it's a community that has a wonderful history. You know, outside the perimeter of all girls, you got the Underground Railroad, you know, which plays significant role. You got the birth of some of the professional athletes, politicians, I mean, doctors, lawyers, you know, it's just that it has a great history that we keep every year, because we 2,000 strong at our annual picnic every year.
I know, you know what? I said this too, like, if you grew up in the gardens, y'all still connected. Like the families know each other. Like when my mom is like, oh yeah, such and such from the gardens, they lived on block H, or, you know, like it's interesting how it's very similar to like the culture of the West Side, and like large families are very, very family oriented. Whereas like growing up on the South Side, you were very transient. You moved from community to community, whereas Altgale Gardens was very generational, and it retained that. And I completely agree that it is culturally significant to our people. And unfortunately, you know, on a side of town where 60% of Chicago's industry is also located. And so as a Black person who does not live on the Southeast Side of Chicago, you wouldn't even bother. Right? Like people drive down the Bishop Ford and they're like, oh, it stinks. But they never ask why. They never ask who's over there. What's happening to my people? So there's a disconnection even in our own community. And so on this slide, we have 1979 is when People for Community Recovery was created, right? And a pamphlet. And so here we are in 2022. The article that's kind of referenced, that's from 2021. Right. So here we are decades later, still having the same conversation about how people in this community or this side of town is harmed. We've had multiple elected officials from this area not taking this on as their primary conversation for how to do redevelopment or how to increase the health, reduce poverty, bring in resources. And so for me, what I hope is that people take from this is that it's our responsibility to understand what's happening in all of these other communities that are adjacent to us. It's not just about Beverly or Chatham or Auburn Gresham. We as people of color need to reflect on how it is that zoning and the presence of industry has been purposely set, right? And how that impacts our quality of lives, the businesses that want to show up, the ability of people to have a healthy life. I didn't know about the Underground Railroad until last year when it became a conversation. And I learned the only Black-owned marina sits right there behind Altgale Gardens. And I asked my mom, like, so why don't we have a boat? Why didn't we have a boat? And she was like, nobody went back there because the other marinas that were on the water were predominantly white. They were very racist. And so while the water and the river was very accessible, it still was inaccessible socially as well as financially for what you need to engage that water. Mm-hmm. And so we are going to move right along and please advance. Into this playlist for a couple of days. I've been having such a good time just kind of savoring, your mom and her work and Black History Month. It means a lot to me, being a Chicagoan and being able to do this in my role here at the Sierra Club. Please advance, Caroline. So, you know, all of your mother's efforts, and we didn't even get to talking about President Clinton and all of the stuff that people know, and that kind of legislative advocacy work, like boots on the ground. For me, I wanted people to understand who this woman was, right? Her life, where she grew up. I want to talk a little bit about you being her legacy. First of all, how does it feel to have to share your mom like this?
Well, I always share my mom. You know, a couple of my best friends became her daughters too. And I used to get jealous about that. So it always been this, she always been either Mama, Mama Hazel, Mama Johnson, you know, to everybody. My mother, people really, were really close, particularly my girlfriends was really close to my mom. I used to have a problem coming up, you know, when I was a teenager, because I lost my father at such a young age, at age 8. So me and her, you know, became, you know, very, very close, because I was a father's baby. And that was some serious adjustments that my mother, some challenge that my mother had to go through with me. She said I was her worst child, so I kind of
believe you were a daddy's girl.
Yeah, I was the daddy, but I was her worst out of 7 kids. She's always told me that. She said, all the kids I got, you got to be my worst one. So she kept me close by her hip as a result, and I'm glad that she did. You know, we believe, you know, having that Southern mentality. You come in her house, you want to eat, we eat, everybody eat, you know, it's just that Southern personality that she brought to this urban city. So when I look at her work and when I look at the things that she has accomplished, you know, and I used to say, out of your 6 kids, why got to make me do this? You know, she said, because you're my worst one and I got to keep you by me. So Cheryl,
you were the one going to all of the meetings and
my brother Johnny started out taking her to different meetings and stuff like that. So I used to work at Argonne National Laboratory. So I used to do all the copying and making the flyers, you know, doing some good with government expense for a change, you know. but otherwise than that, when I came to work for her in 86, you know, that's when we really, really bond. And then in 85, I became a mother too, also first time mother. So, you know, those instincts kicked in when you start making that connection, like, you know, do I want my kid to grow up to be sick? You know, nobody want to have unhealthy or sickly kids. So I knew I had to work with her on that, but I always stayed in the back and allowed her to do what she did the best. She knew how to talk to the public. She knew how to tell her story about her experience, you know, living in an environment where you don't have this information available. You know, it was at a time when she started, when the United States Environmental Protection Agency couldn't help her, because they didn't have no mandate to work with communities. They work with only academic institution and to regulate industry. And that's as a result of the executive order, Environmental Justice Executive Order 12898 that Clinton signed, that began the opening up the resources and allow US EPA to work with community groups and organizations. So
that mother was brilliant in that regard, how she could, like, you know, there are some people that are advocates and we're kind of yelling from the outside, and she had this eye for the angle, like what needs to be filled in order for the work to be fulfilled, right? And she found herself working at different levels, not just for Alt-Gale Gardens, but like just being present where somebody was needed. And your mother didn't have a form, like a full formal education, and she wasn't fully financed. Can you share a little bit about your mother's educational background and how she afforded to participate as an advocate?
Well, you know, my mother, the highest education she had was a sophomore, 10th grade in high school. She dropped out of high school because she was living in California when she was in high school, and then she came back to New Orleans to work. And that's where she met my father. But my mom, after my father passed, you know, she received Social Security for herself and the kids and all his kids. So she used to use her own personal resources, her own money to pay for her to go different places. My older sisters and brothers helped in and supported what she wanted to do. Like my brother Johnny had, my mother didn't drive. So he had a car, so he took her everywhere she needed to go. So it was more like a family thing that supported her work than what she was trying to accomplish at that particular time.
And while she dropped out of 10th grade, she did go to Olive Harvey, right?
Yeah. Oh, I forgot. Yeah, she did go to Olive Harvey College. She actually did 2 years there. She did 2 complete years before her work, and she started moving and going and doing things on a national level that she had to stop going to school. Otherwise, in that, she probably would have graduated with a social degree.
From I'm so mom. Impressed by your mom. You know, and this goes to show, number one, what you can, what do I say, you know, we do as Black people, we rob Peter to pay Paul, but
they can make a dollar out of 15 cents.
Yeah, like this is what we do. Like what she shows is that when you have the will and you have faith and you have energy to do what is right, it will, like, you will be provided for. Whether it is a ride to the location, whether it is, you know, someone to read over your testimony to make sure that it's fluid, or it is, you know, a donation from a person that you don't even know, right? Mm-hmm. The resources find you when you are, I'll say, obedient, you know, to your calling.
I remember, you know, you just brought up an interesting, when they had the first Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro.
Mm-hmm. Was your mom there?
Yes, she went, but she didn't go with the group that organized a group from the United States to go, because she didn't have the money to pay for herself to go, put it like that. She really wanted to go to Rio, and tell you how this, from just what you're saying, we received a call at our office, and a guy asked us, do you fight for environmental justice? I answered the phone. I was like, yes, that's what we do every day. And he asked me, and I told him what we do. The very next day, $10,000 check was at the door.
What?
And I said, Mama, you going to Rio de Janeiro?
Aww.
He said, how I'm going? I said, look. You know, and I didn't even tell her about, you know, I didn't even know this man was going to send anything. It just so happened I was there, and it was like FedEx. It came the very next day, FedEx.
Wow.
And I had to sign for it. And then when I opened it, it was $10,000.
You know.
Then he called a couple of hours later and asked, did we receive it? And I was like, yes. And I was like, thank you.
Wow.
And she went to Rio. We was able to pay for her to go to Rio.
Look at that. Yeah. I mean, I got chills thinking about that, because there's
in Rio, in all her life, she never wore a swimming suit, but she wore a swimming suit there.
Look, being raised around water, down in the swamps too, right?
And putting up feet in, and now mind you, she used to take us to the beach. But I never seen my mother in a swimsuit. But I saw her in a swimsuit in Rio de Janeiro. I got a picture.
I mean, you got a country baby. You gotta show out. Yeah, you gotta show out. So, Cheryl, I want to kind of also give you the the last word for where is People for Community Recovery now? Like what issues, what campaigns, how can people be a part of this legacy?
Well, keeping in alignment with the work of what my mom always does, she always felt that we have a right to live in healthy homes and apartments, you know, so making sure that, and that in particular with subsidizing public housing, there's really not a voice from within. There are structural voices, but it's not voices from it, nothing independent from that. So we make sure that we're still involved with it because clearly on this, you know, I did I emceed just this past Saturday, a town hall meeting about two ordinance that we're trying to, housing ordinance we're trying to pass in the city of Chicago. And it dawned on to me that, you know, Black folks always struggle with housing in this country ever since we came here. And I was like, it was more like we were industrial residents because we came by we came by people who forced the type of way of living. You know, now we into the commercialized residents, because it's never determined. You could take my house anytime and influx it, you know, or tear it down or gentrify my neighborhood. So my source of, as a Black person living in this country for housing, is always commercialized. We're not living to be residential residents.
Yeah.
You know, and that's where we would achieve justice, right, for an example. But connecting that to our environment. Our environment is so important. And there's only two choices that you're going to make, right? Either we're going to live in a healthy community or we're going to live in an unhealthy community. We're going to drink polluted water, or we're going to drink clean water. We're going to breathe polluted air, or we're going to continue to, you know, breathe. Make the choice.
Breathe clean.
But anyway, I lost my thought a little bit. But the bottom line, that's what drives us as an organization. And we try to look at it from that standpoint and try to find solutions to some of these problems that we have. Like, for example, we're into renewable energy real strong because that's an alternative from fossil fuel, from burning any of the emissions that is creating a needed factory just to generate energy for us, right? Why not look at alternative solution? Why electrify things? Why not talk about windmill? Now, I'm not going to even go back to what my mother was telling us in her speeches, that we need to go back to those days. We weren't even thinking about those days, you know, that we are thinking today. So just to keep up with those things and try to be solution orientated and more to just complaining about something in our community. And if something is going to damage our community, we're going to stop it. Like, for an example, the Chicago Public Schools decided that they want to tear down the very first school building that was built in Allgaier without a plan, you know, and we are designated to be historical any day now. So to see that happen, we had to stop that process. So when you talk about health disparity in our community, we know that the people in our community wasn't getting vaccinated because the least of the education really hit down to our community, especially during this experience we had with COVID. So we got involved with the outreach and the education about COVID for our community. So these are some of the things that, you know, we're trying to improve the quality of life for our community and for all communities, you know, and it should not never be infringed on the expense of making money, just like we just seen with General Iron just being denied their permit to operate. They should have never been able to build without having an operating permit. You know,
yeah, so, we're at the
point, you know, where that politics is, it goes back to that politics.
Yep.
You know, so how did that happen? And how come that you can tear down in a white affluent neighborhood, but bring it down to a poor Black and brown neighborhood? And we don't supposed to say anything, but just accept it. And right. And the most important thing that people tend to forget is their behavior and their practices was not in line would operate
in the affluent community. Like they weren't on their best behavior on the best side of town.
On the best, they had an explosion before they even left the north side.
Right.
You know, but you want to put us at risk. So these are just some of the injustices that we have to experience on the far south side of Chicago because we've been hit historically since the 1860 in an industrialized area, a dumping ground for the state of Illinois.
Yep. So, you know, I did a little bit of math. It took that community to 6 years of trying to get them out to successfully remove them from their community. That mm-hmm. is a really, really short time. Mm-hmm. And here we are, 30 years, 50 years. We can't get anybody else to say, get these people out of our city. Right. Not our community. Like our community, I always say 77 equals one, right? We are only as healthy as our most unhealthy community. And it's unfortunate that Chicagoans, because we're so segregated, we do not realize that not every community enjoys the same environmental benefits, even on the south side of the city. Mm-hmm. If you live in Chatham, you don't have the same air quality that people in Southeast Chicago. We do have one question that I want to get to before I turn it over to Tassim. And Hannah asks, if your mom was here with us today, what do you think would bring her joy about the environmental justice movement in Illinois?
Seeing so many people getting engaged with it, you know, to see that, you know, it's people are talking about it. I wouldn't call it a conversation because people are talking about, people are planning around environmental justice, and we as communities trying to do something about the environmental injustice in our community. And we got a platform, you know, but how long this platform is another question, but you can't measure that. It's just my mother said, just be continued to fight for what you believe in. Wrong is wrong and right is right. We have a right to live a better quality of life than what we live in that today. And you're not going to get it by being silenced.
Thank you so much, Cheryl. Can you please advance, Caroline? So, you know, I want to echo Marcy's comments. Hazel was an amazing trailblazer. I think we're all in awe of her and grateful to learn about her. I want to thank everyone. Stick around because we're not done. But Cheryl, are there any final, you know, maybe very brief, like 25 seconds, 30 seconds, you want to tell people how to follow you, how to donate before we turn it over to Tassim?
Oh, sure. Thank you for having this discussion. And I am truly honored to be here talking about the work of my mom. You know, we can be reached at People for Community. Our website is peopleforcommunityrecovery.org, but also we need help in pushing this three pieces of legislation that we're trying to get passed on the federal level because it gives us a platform. It gives us a place in history at the African American Museum in DC because we will not get the Congressional Medal. It will be placed in the museum in DC. That given us a platform, that given us a room to bring in all the other environmental leaders that are fighting or to elevate the education and awareness about the work that's going on around this country or abroad. So having that to be able to look at helping us get these three legislation passed would be a great honor. And all the information is on our website and donation buttons is on the website at peopleforcommunityrecovery.org.
Thank you so much, Cheryl. And so before I head over to Tassim, enjoy this little vibe.
Cool. excuse me. Before we get started with this next section, I wanted to pass it over to Jordan. I think you had a question.
Yeah, thank you so much, Sassine. Cheryl, I wanted to hear your thoughts on this. I know so much of the victories we see in environmental justice and within at a community level is based on the tightness of that community itself and how they're able to stick together and create a common narrative around the same issue. And I was just curious if you had any insights on what it was within Altgeld Gardens and in your time and your mom's time that makes that community so noteworthy in its ability to bring attention to environmental justice issues.
It's because it became a personal issue. It became a health issue, you know, it became a public health issues. And, you know, mothers, they, you know, we the caregivers of our children, and we're gonna protect them more than we protect our husbands and our boyfriends and our spouses, right? You can mess with them, but you can't mess with our babies, right? So I think that's that type of innate that comes out of making sure, you know, and then paying attention to how come when my baby go outside and play so long, next thing you know, it come in the house, it's wheezing. Why is it wheezing? You know, why has it got, then the general question is, why my baby got asthma? You know, you start in the, you know, because it was so many people in the same neighborhood that had experienced cancer and respiratory and skin infections that we starting to say it wasn't right. Something ain't right. We need to find this out. Now, mind you, when we started, it was hell going through trying to find out. What government already knew what they was doing to us, but we had to prove to them that they was doing this to us, you know, and that's still relevant as I speak today, you know. So it's just that I think, and being in an isolated area and being so disconnected, the city, every level of government diss us in our area, it brought some kind of cohesiveness to this area. You know, sometimes, you know, being labeled as public housing, you know, comes off with a negative connotation to the public. But all of us depend on some kind of public support, whether you default on your loan and the government pick it up, or you default on your education system, you know, loans, you get in default on it. But we don't look at those things. But I think that everybody has a right to public housing, and housing should be affordable for everybody. You know, so don't just look at it just as public housing, because public housing has grades. It works on a scale. It's not just that people is just paying this low. It's just low payment. We do pay rent to support this neighborhood. We just don't have this the economy like we used to have in our own community. All the money in our community really has been diverted out. I remember my first grade teacher living in the community. I remember people running the business, the cleanesses, the Norfolk family. People live out here, right? So that capital's circulating in the community. We don't have those things now. And that's what you see. And now we are a deserted community, you know? But that was that design, that was structurally what we wanted to see as a community, you know. But nobody talk about the exploitation of low-income communities. You know, energy burdens. It has been documented that ComEd pays more. I mean, people that have ComEd bill pay in low-income community pay more than affluent and middle-class community. And that has been documented. So when you look at all those different environmental disparities, it can only do force community to come together when you see a pattern. I know that was a long answer, but I get into it. So
No, I really appreciate the detail. Thank you so much.
Cool. So thank you, Mila. Thank you, Cheryl, and all of you for joining us today. I am going to lead us into our second portion of the call, which is our advocacy section. I'll talk a little bit about these three pieces of legislation, like Courtney mentioned, introduced by Bobby Rush, and then we're going to write our reps and call our reps. So again, like we talked about at the beginning of this presentation, Representative Bobby Rush recently introduced legislation honoring the work and the legacy of Hazel Johnson. This kind of recognition is a way to highlight EJ fights happening not just here in Chicago, but across the country as well, which in turn gives us more opportunities as activists to hold big industry accountable when they enter communities already overburdened with pollution. There are currently three bills that we want more Illinois reps to co-sponsor. The first is House Resolution 79 that urges Americans to observe each April as Hazel M. Johnson Environmental Justice Month. The second is House Bill 673 that would create a commemorative postage stamp in her honor. And the last is House Bill 674 that would, and I'm going to butcher this word, posthumously present Ms. Johnson with a Congressional Gold Medal in recognition of her achievements and contributions to the environmental justice movement. Next slide, please. So why do these bills matter? These three bills will emphasize the importance of community-led environmental justice policy solutions and lift up the leadership of those like Cheryl's, like Hazel's, with the most knowledge and direct experience of the effects of the climate crisis. These bills will also create an opportunity for the nation to reflect on and reckon with how to be a more just society. I know for me, advocating for these three bills is important because as a Chicagoan and as a climate activist, I'm very proud to have Hazel Johnson as someone to look up to. These bills give Americans an opportunity to similarly memorialize a Chicago hero as a role model to ensure Hazel's legacy can continue to shape national conversations on environmental racism and environmental justice in the United States. And lastly, as we celebrate Black History Month, this legislation provides a crucial opportunity to honor an important figure in America's history. Next slide, please. So I am going to put a toolkit in the chat so we can start contacting our representatives and asking them to co-sponsor these three bills. I personally think that one way as activists, we can pressure our elected officials to act in our favor, or one way we could do that is to make sure that they hear directly from us. It may seem a little daunting to call them, but at the end of the day, electeds are in office to advocate for constituents, AKA us. So if you click on the link, the first link will take you to an Action Network website where you can put in your personal information and then send an email to your representatives. It is possible to edit the text in the little blurb before you send it. I encourage you to write a little bit about why you personally want to advocate for this legislation and see it co-sponsored. The second link will take you to a website where you can find your representative's contact information. You put in your zip code, and if you can't find your rep immediately, then you can put in your address and find who your rep is from there. It'll take you to their constituent website, and then if you hit contact information, you'll see a DC office number and a Illinois office number. I would recommend calling their Illinois office. There's a phone banking script, not phone banking script, just a script there as well. Again, feel free to personalize it and make it your own.
Thanks, Tassine. And I see a question from Marcy about tweeting about these bills. And who would be good to include. I would, if you can tweet about this, that would be great. A few ideas. One would be sharing the action page where people can like write into their legislators. That's the first link in the document to seem shared. And then I think another thing that would be great is if you can tag your US representative, that would also be really great. Just saying, hey, I just learned about these three bills. They seem really awesome. Please co-sponsor them, and sharing, you know, whatever other personal things you want to share. I already filled out the action alert. I'm gonna go ahead and call my representative once we hang up. I wanna give a huge, huge thank you to People for Community Recovery for joining us. Thank you, Courtney and Cheryl, for helping organize, and Cheryl for sharing more about your mom and about all of the incredible work People for Community Recovery has done over the decades. And I look forward to working with everyone on this call to make sure that we can pass these bills. And I can't wait to send some letters with a Hazel Johnson postage stamp on them.
Oh, thank you, Caroline. I appreciate it very much. And I thank Sierra Club and the relationship that we have grown over the years, you know, has been really a great opportunity for all of us here.
Thank you again for joining us, and look forward to passing this bill among these three bills, among many other things in the future. And thank you everyone for joining us. We'll be sending out follow-up information. I will also put my email in the chat. If people have any follow-up questions, you can contact me and I will get you connected to the right person.